Good evening and welcome to the teleconferencing session of Chair for Sustainable Development. Respected regional directors, counselors and students, welcome to this induction program scheduled for the first PG diploma in sustainability science. Because this is one of the first programs on PG diploma in sustainability science from Chair for Sustainable Development, we have with us Professor M.S. Swaminathan, who will be guiding us and giving the blessings for this program. We have Dr. Lata Pillai, Executive Director for Chair for Sustainable Development, Dr. P.C. Keshwan, who is the mentor for this program, Mr. Kuman, who is the coordinator for the program. We have also invited the counselors who will be counseling you through online program. I welcome all the counselors, particularly Professor Swarna Vapi, Dr. Bipu Nayak, Dr. Hemlata, and other colleagues from the School of Agriculture, Extension and Development Studies. We welcome all of them. I request Dr. Lata Pillai to welcome the chief guest and Professor Swaminathan and all the counselors, please.
On behalf of the Chair for Sustainable Development, I would like to extend a warm welcome to Professor M.S. Swaminathan, Professor Keshavan, and all the counselors who are present here. The students of the first batch of postgraduate diploma in sustainability science, I think, are really blessed because they will have the benefit of an induction program by a stalwart Professor M.S. Swaminathan. We started the activities of the Chair for Sustainable Development with an appreciation program on sustainability science, and out of the experience and feedback that we got, we began working on this postgraduate diploma. Within a short time, for the first batch, we've been able to get 33 learners enrolled, and I hope that the regional directors will do the needful to popularize the program in their states and regions. Professor M.S. Swaminathan will be giving the induction lecture, followed by Professor Keshavan. So I would not like to take any more of your time except to welcome them to this session and the students to benefit from the interaction that they will have here today.
Thank you, madam. I request the counselors and the students to kindly note down our toll-free numbers. The numbers are 1-800-112345 and 2953-2844 and 2953-2845. The students can watch the program on their computer also. You can log in to our Gyan Darshan program, and you can also have the programs through this also, through teleconferencing session. Now I will request Professor M.S. Swaminathan, sir, to kindly address and bless the students, please.
Professor Lata Pillai, Professor Keshavan, Professor Saluja, Dr. Kuman, the scholars who are taking up this course, the counselors, and other distinguished participants. First of all, I wish to congratulate and thank the Indira Gandhi National Open University for starting the series of courses in the field of sustainability science. As you see, the word has two, sustainability and science. Science, as Jawaharlal Nehru once said, that the future belongs to science and those who make friendship with science. Because if there is a problem, there is a solution. You will have to find a scientific solution. If it's a technological problem, only science can solve the problem. The other is sustainability. Sustainability, for too long we thought, means our economic sustainability. In other words, having money to buy and so on. A business, for example, the balance sheet shows whether it's sustainable or not. If your balance sheet is very adverse, not sustainable. Then came the environmental issues, because a large number of enterprises, business activities, like for example mining, all of them depend on natural resource. Agriculture depends entirely on natural resources, land, water, biodiversity and climate. Therefore, the sustainable management of the basic life support systems which support life on this earth, like land, water, it becomes very important. And the third aspect is social sustainability, because whatever we do must benefit everybody. If there are winners and losers, it will not be sustainable, because the losers will always be against what has been done. Therefore, sustainability science is bringing the best of inquiry, the best of questioning mind, best of knowledge, because as Spencer said, science is search after truth. You try to find out what is the correct one. How do you make development or our own living sustainable? This is the purpose of this course, and I am very happy that we had the privilege of having Professor Keshavan and our distinguished counselors and many others to help to put the course together. May I say a few words about the different aspects of sustainability science, which whoever is taking the courses, they will hear more about it, they will learn more about it. First of all, in the environmental sustainability, which is now on the forefront, next year is what we call Rio Plus 20, 20 years after the Earth Summit held in Rio de Janeiro in June 1992, and 40 years after Stockholm, the first human United Nations conference on the human environment was held in Stockholm in 1972. And that's where Indira Gandhi made the famous statement that unless you look after the poor and look after the human dimension of sustainability, purely talking about the panda, the penguin and all the other the symbols of conservation, that will not be done, it cannot be managed unless you also look after the human beings. That is how the concept of social sustainability was introduced in the whole question of measurement of sustainability. The environmental sustainability of the life support system, for example, this course talks about from the green to an evergreen revolution. I mentioned earlier, agriculture is a profession which depends on soil, water, biodiversity and climate, among other things. Obviously, all the soil fertility must be maintained. Evergreen revolution means improvement of productivity in perpetuity without ecological harm. Because the Green Revolution was criticized by environmentalists by saying excessive use of fertilizer, excessive use of pesticide, overdrawing of water. Take for example Punjab. The Punjab agriculture is both in economic and ecological distress. Ecological distress because the groundwater has been overexploited. Salinity has come up and so on. That is not sustainable. We have to maintain. This is why agriculture sustainability, which is the basis of sustainable food security, will have to be based upon the conservation, not only the conservation, but the enhancement of our resources like soil. Soil fertility not only should be maintained, but should be improved by introducing earthworms and so on. Many methods, biofertilizers, you can improve it. Same is both water, quality. It was silenced, the book by Rachel Carson, Silent Spring, in 1964, which started a serious thought on the question of environmental sustainability, because what we call Green Revolution really started in the United States in the late 40s, when they started growing more of hybrid corn, hybrid maize, with a large amount of fertilizer, and soon use of fertilizer and DDT as a pesticide was very widespread, with the result eutrophication of the lakes, the pollution of the lakes, the water, all of them was described by in the book, beautiful book on Silent Spring. From that time onwards, we became conscious of the need to look at the environmental impact of development. Impact of development, whether it is agricultural development or industrial development or any kind of manufacturing. For example, the state where I live now, Tamil Nadu, the two major industries are leather and textiles. both of them are in distress because the leather effluents from the leather industry are polluting the water and so on. Similarly, the famous place called Tirupur, where in one small town over 1,000 crores worth of foreign exchange is being earned by export of textiles. Unfortunately, again, the dye pollution, if you go to the river nearby, so that our courts, now the green benches are there in our courts, they have said that it should be either stopped, pollution should be stopped, or the industry should be closed. Either way, closing industry is not an option for us, because there were population of 120 crore of people, 1.2 billion people, we have, out of whom more than 50% are below the age of 30. They require jobs, they require some income and so on. Therefore, we have to create more jobs and not just close down the jobs we already have. Now, in the case of economics, I am happy we have outstanding counselors who have developed a program on ecological economics. The difference between normal economics and environmental economics is, environmental economics, we can't allow depreciation. How do you allow depreciation to water or soil or climate and so on? And otherwise, in conventional economics, depreciation is almost compulsory. You have to, towards the top level, have to show depreciation for all the assets of IGNO. But in the case of environmental assets, we can't, we can only appreciate, not depreciate. The other important difference is the environmental economics take into account intergenerational equity, not only intragenerational. It is not only the population which is now inhabiting India, but also the children, the women and men who are yet to be born, the children who are yet to be born. Their own fate is also important. What we do today may determine their fate in the future. So in all these areas, whether ecological economics or environmental economics, we require a much more detailed understanding of both the long term and the short term development. This is why the Brundtland Commission, chaired by Mrs. Gro Harlan Brundtland, then Prime Minister of Norway, a very famous report called Our Common Future, it emphasized that sustainable development means development today should not be at the expense of prospects for development tomorrow. In other words, today and tomorrow are not in conflict, but which are mutually reinforced. And this is why the Brundtland Reports Commission was also called Our Common Future, to underline the fact, whether it is within a country or among nations, whatever may be our political frontiers, ecologically our fates are intertwined. Today we have a debate on climate change. You may go on talking, who is responsible for climate change? Industrialized countries, obviously, their emissions are very high. The carbon emissions are more than carbon absorption. Therefore, you have all the time problem. But who is going to have the impact? It is not, the worst impact will be on developing countries, on poor nations, and the poor on all nations. For example, in agriculture, 1 to 2 degrees centigrade higher temperature, which is what they are negotiating at various international conferences, will affect our own wheat production, our rice production and so on. And sub-Saharan Africa and South Asia will be the worst affected by an increase in temperature. We may say we are not responsible for it, but the fact remains, whoever is responsible, the impact will be on those who will suffer. This is why it is called Our Common Future. The report is called Our Common Future, to emphasize that all of us are ecologically intertwined, what is called the web of life, the web of life. If you destroy one segment of the web, the whole web collapses. And this is what we have to learn. Let me say a few words about the whole question of food security, sustainable food security, because food is the first among the hierarchical needs of a human being. And these days we talk about hunger strikes and so on. People say, how long can you be without food? And some people can live longer, some people cannot live as long and so on. Therefore, food is a fundamental requirement, and that is endangered today. On the one hand, what is called the fatigue of the Green Revolution. The reason is that environmental problems, ecological problems, the land, the water, biodiversity, and above all the climate, climate issues, more frequent droughts, more frequent floods, more because the Himalayan snow melt will require more, and then rise in sea level all along the coastline. Nearly one third of the population of India live within 50 kilometers from the shoreline, and the world as a whole, nearly 40% live near the shoreline. If the sea level is going to go up, we have had some example of tsunami. The tsunami of 2004, December 26, 2004, was a wake-up call, as we call them. Our people could get an idea what a tsunami means, what sea level rise will mean, and so on. So we have problems along the coast, along the islands, Andaman Nicobar Islands, as well as of Lakshadweep group of islands. Here, my last point is there is a lot of traditional wisdom on dealing with climate change, with adaptation. When Professor Keshavan led a team to develop a plan for the Andamans, the report, he called it Post-Tsunami, the New Andamans. There he pointed out that the various tribes in Nicobar Island, the Great Nicobar, which was the nearest to the epicenter of the tsunami, because in Sumatra, very near, people thought that the tribal people are all drowned and dead, because there was no news. Even the media said, we don't know what has happened to these people. But then he found they were all hale and hearty. When asked, they said, they gave a number of indicators of something. They didn't call it tsunami, something terrible happening in the sea, the way in which some wave came and receded very fast, the crab's behavior and so on. So they got onto the top of the highest tree, tallest tree they could get hold of. So after 2 days they came down. People were surprised. This is what we call indigenous knowledge or traditional wisdom. So we have to, in sustainability science, to be sustainable, we have to blend modern science with traditional wisdom, traditional knowledge. Both of them have to come together, otherwise we will lose the wisdom of the ages. For example, water harvesting. The Center for Science and Environment has a book called Dying Wisdom. Sunita Narayan and Agarwal, Anil Agarwal, who is no more, they have pointed out what are all the methods which were used in the past for harvesting water. A place like Chirapunji or Sora, as it is now called, in Meghalaya, with 14,000 millimeters of rainfall, you don't get water during the month of December, January, February. On the other hand, if you go to Barmer, Jaisalmer, with 50 to 60 millimeters of rainfall, remember 14,000 and 60, somehow people give you some water. If you go there, the first thing the lady does is to give you some water and so on. There are traditional methods of water conservation. So we must revive in the field of sustainability science. Those who are taking this course should remember the first important requirement for sustainable development is sustainable lifestyles. Sustainable lifestyles where we conserve the conservation, a life devoted to conserving the water, conserving electricity, whatever, or energy and so on, the conservation ethos must permeate. Unsustainable lifestyles and unacceptable poverty, these are the two greatest enemies of sustainable development. Unsustainable lifestyles, because we will make too much demand on natural resources, what is now called ecological footprint. Each one of us, the demand we make on natural resource. And unacceptable poverty, because then there will be no social sustainability. There will always be conflicts, there will be problems, there will be violence, social, in a way, what is now called Arab Spring, what has happened in the Middle East, is attributed to growing extreme affluence and extreme poverty. Up to a point, people are willing to take it. Afterward, they will not take it. This is why I said social sustainability important. I hope all the scholars and others who take this course on sustainability science will at least promote the concept that sustainability demands the end of unsustainable lifestyle and unacceptable poverty. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for guiding and blessing the students and overall covering about the sustainability science and focusing on the conservation ethos. Sir, now I will request Professor P.C. Keshavan, who is the mentor for this program, to share the important features of the program, please.
Professor Swaminathan, who has been the real guiding spirit for this, Dr. Lata Pillai, who is the executive director in addition to being the co-vice chancellor of the IGNU. She has given us all the support. Then Dr. Saluja, who has been a coordinator and giving us all help, and Mr. Kuman, and all the counselors, faculty like Dr. Faruqi, Dr. Yadav, and so on. All these people have been behind this onerous task of developing a program. We would not have succeeded but for the constant and inspiring guidance of Professor Swaminathan, who has very elegantly summarized the entire concept of sustainability science and how that is going to have to work for sustainable development. I remember reading in an editorial in Science that was published in 2007. What it said was, with immense knowledge of physics, chemistry, and so on, we are not able to address some of the emerging problems. There have been profound changes in society, profound changes in environment, profound changes in ever so many things that are dear to not only the humans but the entire biosphere. But these knowledge, so much available in physics and chemistry, cannot come to cope with this problem, cannot come to solve these problems. Alongside, as Professor Swaminathan pointed out, there had been a vicious spiral operating between poverty and environmental degradation, a concept that was first introduced into the United Nations conference by late Madam Gandhi, who was then the Prime Minister of India and would lead the delegation. Starting from this, a number of things have been said about how we have to switch over from a unsustainable pathway of development into a sustainable one. But that has been said more easily, but the avenues to develop what it is, how are we going to do it, has not been that easy. Even today, I want to take all the students who are going to take taking this course into confidence to say that this course is an emerging one. The postgraduate diploma program that we have developed, which consists of 8 courses, 32 blocks and 128 units, have good contents, but these are not the final ones. We are going on absorbing the new information, because as you know, Professor Swaminathan referred to Brundtland's Commission report, an excellent report that tells you that ecologically our destinies are entwined. Notwithstanding that, there have been some problems of defining what are the needs. The future generations would have to have enough resources to meet their own needs. But what are these needs? Are we talking about the basic needs? Are the needs of the corporate sector? Are the needs of others who are indulging in, let's say, illegal mining and so on? See, the needs are very different. So how are we going to scale this? The other aspect of it is, what are the wherewithals? Yes, we have said that we have to sustain the ecological foundations, such as the fertile soil. You refer to the situation in Punjab and so on, where, you know, because of the drawing the water, bringing about the salinization of the soil and causing the degradation of the environment and the depletion and extinction of biodiversity and so on. All these are problems. Humans forgot for a while after the Industrial Revolution that we are part of the nature and we cannot come to govern or dictate over nature. That is what has happened. So in consequence, what really has happened is that we have to now change our path of development, and also probably, if I may say, you would realize pace of development. Now, for Swaminathan referred to the ecological economics. What is this ecological economics? Why is that? Why has it become necessary as an integral part of the postgraduate diploma in sustainability science? The neoclassical economics that has been rigorously followed, and which, in my opinion, has been the one which has been promoting rivalry and competition among the countries under the globalized trade system, is ignoring ecology completely, as also the societal needs, social and ecological aspects have been completely forgotten. When you talk about sustainability, you have to recognize that there are 3 basic pillars. The first one is the ecological. The second is the social, and third is the economic. So if you put economics in the center and it goes on like a very hungry organism swallowing up everything, and ultimately you find that the resources would not be there for your children and their children to meet their own needs. So the Brundtland Commission report, well, it has elegantly said our own pathway of development so far has been anything in accordance with that. It has been rather contrary to it. Then we come back to the other things. When we want to bring sustainability science, obviously it is not nature alone, but society. Both societies and nature, natural systems are dynamic, rapidly evolving. Take for example, what are the domains, what are the basic foundations or principles of natural sciences? Take physics. It immediately tells you about gravity. I'm giving one example. There are other laws. Gravitational law is important. Thermodynamic principles are important. And you come to the biological world. What is important? Natural selection. So man has interfered with natural selection to a great extent in many ways. And there have been disobedience of the laws in many ways, and with the result, the human dent on the biosphere has been very severe. Professor Swaminathan also referred to the climate change. While what is called the Hotline Institute in Chicago tells that bulk of the climate change is not really anthropogenic. In other words, it's not the human made, but there have been other factors, the solar cycles and so on. But there is indeed also a component of the humans. And this is very important in terms of having to plan mitigation, adaptation, etc. And then in all this, every sphere, in formulating this course, postgraduate diploma, what we have done is to bring some of the fundamentals of various social sciences and natural sciences, like biodiversity, ecology, and so on. On the other hand, the economics, the social structures, institutions, policies, whole lot of things we have been able to bring together. And we have also tried to not keep them as separate. Each one has to have a bearing on the target, on the goal, that is namely sustainable development. So here is a question of developing a science. Why that science? As I told you, the conventional physics, chemistry, and also social sciences have not been able to address the knowledge gaps that are there and which need to be bridged in achieving the sustainable development. So our endeavors in this regard has been to develop this. Again, I must also refer to one thing. Much of our inspiration to develop this sustainability science course, PG diploma, came but both from Professor Swaminathan, the honorary chair to this, and also from the administration, particularly the dynamic vice chancellor, Professor Rajasekharan Pillai, Dr. Pro vice chancellor, Dr. Lata Pillai, and others, and also from, as a feedback from the students who have taken some of the appreciation program on sustainability science, as appreciation program on the Himalayan systems, mountain systems, river systems. All these people have been giving us the feedback with which we realized that there is a need to have to develop it, bring more subject material into it in order to build a program that would be really sustainability science. I must also briefly refer to one other thing, that this basically there have also been certain problems in bringing things together. Because as I mentioned, the natural sciences have got a different kind of principles like thermodynamics and so on. When you come to the social sciences, there you find the societies, if you take for example, they are not having the same principles as nature and natural sciences. Their principles are quite different. What are the principles we have? Take for example, we have competition, we have demography, we have population, we have cultures, we have various other kinds of issues, some of which like even corruption and so on. All these are competition threat. All these constitute your social sciences and which make you, societies, and which make you very dynamic. So coming back to the issue of having to reduce equities, Professor Swaminathan also referred to the social gender inequities. And inequities, he mentioned, are a stumbling block to achieving the sustainable development. So what are we going to do about it? How are we going to tackle these problems? You know, I'm addressing the students essentially to make them appreciate that I said in the early beginning, we have brought it to a good stage. We have developed a program better than we thought we would be able to. We are very happy about it. But I also told you, and I'm emphasizing, that we need to get it even better, and that is possible. The knowledge explosion is taking place today. People are beginning to realize that sustainable development cannot have a single formula. Take for example a country like Japan. To them, agriculture may not be the major thrust for sustainable development and sustaining the human population. Sustainable development has also assumed a new dimension today. We have begun talking in terms of survival. Survival of humans and all other fellow species. As a matter of fact, I must tell you, Professor Swaminathan is the author, as you know, is basic contribution to the society, to the nation, the world, is the Green Revolution. But he didn't call it a Green Revolution. He called it exploitative agriculture. The term Green Revolution was coined by William Gadd of USDA, United States Department of Agriculture. The reason we called it exploitative agriculture is that this is only to provide a breathing space. We wanted a kind of crop having a certain morphology, and that would be able to take up a lot of fertilizers, take up a lot of water, and with the help of solar energy and photosynthetic process, would be able to build more starch to the grains. And that will not fall off or lodge, it will stand erect because of the plant morphology, and that brought about the Green Revolution, which was the need of the hour. But he had also very clearly, as early as 1968, mentioned, cautioned rather, that this green agriculture, this green revolution, or you call it exploitative agriculture, will not be sustainable. In long term, over a long period of time, it would leave ecological and social harm. Therefore, we have to switch to that to a sustainable thing. So if I can say, even before the UN Conference on Human Environment, here is the person who introduced the concept of sustainable development through something that was necessary, which was not at that particular point of time. He knew it was not sustainable, but he had to do it because that was the need of the hour. Otherwise, we were having a begging bowl in our hand. Now, over the years, for India, what has become important, as he has himself initiated the principle of evergreen revolution. Evergreen revolution has two components there. This is a very important core, and therefore I'm going to spend 2 minutes on it. Evergreen revolution is the most relevant one for India and also many developing countries. Why do I say that? Evergreen revolution has got certain principles of making use of the natural resources of a given area and sustainably managing it and creating livelihoods out of it. India is today the home of the largest number of hungry people. And it was so even just after the Green Revolution. Why is there is so much of food, yet there are so many hungry people? Why is it? Why is this strange paradox of mountains of grains on one hand and millions of hungry people on the other? Because they don't have access to food. This is something Professor Vepa is here, and she, along with Professor Swaminathan and others, have developed a beautiful atlas called Food Insecurity Atlas of the Rural India, Food Insecurity Atlas of Urban India, and so on. All these go to show that availability of food is just one part of it, but you have to get access. And Professor Swaminathan also added absorption, meaning that you have to have green, clean drinking water. Otherwise, what happens is, you know, dysentery and other kinds of things, ingested food is lost. So the point is that evergreen revolution is important to us in order to be able to produce, as you said, food in perpetuity without causing ecological harm, and also develop rural eco-enterprises, rural livelihoods, because we have to fight in our country not only the famine of food but also famine of livelihoods. Both these are integrated, and using appropriate technologies like the conventional biotechnology and also the taking advantage of the modern information communication technologies through village knowledge centers, village resource centers, and so on. All these have been included in your syllabus. What I'm saying is that for India, agriculture would continue to be the primary source of livelihood and food production. Also, we must remember the famous words said by Prof. Swaminathan in one of the articles. He writes every day an article. One of the articles that he had written was that the countries with grains would dictate the terms in years to come, and not the countries with guns, because you can purchase the guns if you have grains. So these are very important things. So people, the students who are going to take this course, who are taking it, we welcome, and also we would like to tell you that we have to have a periodic interaction on all these matters, and I'm only here trying to explain why we have given greater importance to evergreen revolution, biodiversity, and ecological domain, ecological economics, and other related issues. And also, of course, we have covered policies, international policies, governance. All these are there in this course, of which are 8 courses, 32 blocks, as I mentioned. But the importance is the core, you have to always think of it. I personally, in my personal way, I believe that automobile hubs and others will not be sustainable in years to come, because, as you know, the world as a whole has gone into what is called the peak oil point. We have reached the peak, and now it's going to decline. In about 30 years, there won't be oil, fossil fuels. And if there are no fossil fuels, what is it that we are going to do with hundreds of thousands of automobiles that's made? It will raise your economy today, but what are we going to do tomorrow after that? we won't have any space to put all this automobile junk, you know, because that is also taken up by e-waste. Another thing is, you see, technology is always two-edged weapon, as Prof. Swaminathan often said. Now we are having nano-waste. And I don't know if you know that e-waste, electronic waste, is far more dangerous than nuclear waste. We are very worried about the nuclear waste. Now, because why do I say that? Because, you know, nuclear waste is could be segregated into high-level solid waste, medium-level and low-level liquids and so on. And solid levels can be vitrified and can be buried in certain places. Whereas, and it's government-controlled, nation-controlled. So bulk is conducted in one place. Whereas every one of us has got a mobile phone, everyone has got TV, monitor, your PCs, and so on. And these are also having rapid turnover. And India is today is only next to the United States in the million tons of e-waste. Where does it go? Into the soil. Can you recycle that? No. Cadmium, mercury, etc. He referred to pollution also. All these are not non-cyclable. Earth's capacity is not there to cycle it. So they go into the groundwater. And recently I read that the cancer incidence has gone up by about 23% in the last 10 years. This is not unexpected, because we are abusing ourselves through the environmental abuse, pollutions and so on. So this course, postgraduate diploma course, is tailored, if I may say, to take into the fundamentals from varied natural sciences as are relevant to achieving the sustainable development. And also we have taken basic material from the social sciences, economics and so on, and integrate them in a certain manner, in a mutually reinforcing manner, mutually supportive manner, to understand what should be the best way to achieve this. And so far India is concerned, we have got to have the evergreen revolution, our agriculture, to sustain our livelihoods, our lives, and everything that is going to give us a longer lease on existence on this planet. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Respected counselors and students, as you know, one of the objectives is to share the mechanism of teaching learning process with all the students and the counselors. We are thankful to Professor Swaminathan and Dr. Keshwan for sharing the philosophical foundation of this complete program. We'll be dealing in more depth about the other thing aspects, particularly counseling sessions, program guide, which we have already posted on the our website on the SAFE platform, and how to see the program on the different in the Gyan Kosh and the teleconferencing we have already shared. Now I will keep it open for the discussion, because interaction will create more stimulation for the growth. I was given our toll-free number 1-800-112345, and we have also given that the other number is 2953-2844 and 2845. I will request the counselors and students who are present to kindly call and have more information on the subject. In meanwhile, I will request the counselors and the invitees, like Professor, our PVC, Dr. Ramanjan, and other counselors who are present, they can also ask the questions about the philosophical foundation, please. Yes, please.
Professor Swaminathan, we see today there is a very great conflict of interest between various groups involved in progress or development. On one side are those groups who are producing for the society. They are industry or business houses, corporates. And on the other side is the those agencies who are governing these or who are responsible for keeping development under control so that everything remains sustainable. So there is, we see a conflict of interest in these two, on the two sides. Mm-hmm. You think we will be in a position to handle, or how we can handle this conflict?
You know, this is a very important question you asked, our issue. which is confronting all those concerned with development, so-called development. How do you make development sustainable? How do you avoid the conflict between environment and development? And usually everyone we put, if say tourism, you put eco-tourism. If you put mining, you put eco-mining. But then what is eco-mining? What is eco-tourism? Or what is eco-agriculture? This is where, as Professor Keshavan said, each one of them will have to work out what is the alternative method. How do you have the cake and eat it too? That's the question which... so far, we have not been concerned with the sustainability part, the earlier development. In fact, all industrialized countries developed under conditions where they had no regard for environment. This is the reason why they have come, now the emissions are very high, the per capita energy consumption is very high, most of the biodiversity is lost and so on. We have to learn from them. But developing countries are now on the pathway of development which takes into consideration the impact on environment. And so our pace will be slower. For example, if you shift from chemical farming to organic farming, if I apply urea or whatever, then immediately you see the impact. The leaves look green, the yield goes up. But then if I want to go through the organic pathway of improving soil fertility, it takes time. You have to conserve all the manure, cow manure, buffalo, every one of them and so on. So the conflict between environment and development is in some way, it is not a conflict, it's a method of approach to development. And that is why the word sustainable development shows it is sustainable over time. You are not doing harm to the generations yet to be born. Your ecological footprint does not exceed the biocapacity of the environment and so on. Every country in every field, energy will have to develop method of harmonizing development and environment. Agriculture, we have to harmonize. Industry, you will have to harmonize the recycling and so on. So, in fact, this is one of the first questions which was asked to the new Minister for Environment in a debate with Karan Thapar. He said, how are you going to reconcile? Because people want development. The government wants 9.5% growth rate, 10% growth rate. On the other hand, we know much of it is at the expense of natural resources, unsustainable use of natural resources. This is one of the main purpose of this particular course, at least to awaken the need to harmonize environment and development. How will you do it? We'll have to sector by sector. Every sector one has to work out. This is where this morning I was having conversation with the Vice Chancellor of the Cambridge University in England, and he was saying that their whole emphasis now, the new initiative they have started in the heart of Cambridge, they are putting a very big center for conservation science and sustainability science. He said, we want to, educational institutions have this responsibility, not only to say you must be environmentally conscious, but also to show how environmental awareness can permeate whole development.
Thank you, sir. I think we'll be sustainable with our program also. I will request Mr. Kuman, the coordinator, to have a vote of thanks, please.
At the outset, I would like to give my sincere thanks to Professor Swaminathan, sir, for his valuable time and to come here to blessing to all of us, especially to the student. In his message, he mentioned those the first student as crusader of sustainable development. We are very lucky to get this name, especially this first batch student. And I would like to give thanks to all the faculty who are in this hall and this studio, and to all the regional scientists and who are attending the counseling session, and looking forward to see you tomorrow in the next counseling session. Thanks all.
Thank you. We'll be putting this on our e-platform, that is safe platform. This will be available to all the students and the counselors who have missed today. Thank you, sir. Thank you to everyone, please.